In the last video, I described how to generate a recombinant DNA plasmid containing the cDNA for your favorite gene. Now I will talk about introducing the plasmid into the bacterium Escherichia coli and verifying that the bacteria contain a plasmid with the desired sequence. The process by which a plasmid is introduced into bacteria is called transformation. There are two main ways to transform bacteria. In electroporation, you mix the plasmid and your bacteria under certain conditions. Then you expose the cells to an electric current. This causes some of the cells to take up the plasmid. The second method involves treating cells with chemicals, often divalent cations such as calcium, to make them competent. The word competent in this context simply means that the cells are capable of taking up foreign DNA. Mixing the cells and plasmid together and then quickly warming up the cells in a heat shock induces some cells to take up the plasmid. Note that in both methods, for the plasmid to remain stable in the bacterium, it must be circular. Linear DNA is degraded by the bacteria. After transformation, you incubate the cells on an agar plate containing antibiotic that corresponds to the selectable marker that is on the plasmid. Cells that contain the plasmid will be resistant to antibiotic and will grow on your plate to form colonies. You know that every colony on the plate is resistant to antibiotic, but that's no guarantee that the plasmid contains the insert that you want. For example, maybe the ends of the cut plasmid were ligated back together without the insert. If that happened, then a colony that took up the plasmid would be resistant to antibiotic, but it would not contain the cDNA that you wanted to. Therefore, we must test some of these colonies to find one that contains the recombinant plasmid that we tried to create. There are several ways to check transformed colonies to see whether they contain a plasmid with the insert. In each method, you would grow up a culture of the colony and isolate plasmid DNA from the cells. There are well-established methods to purify plasmid DNA from bacteria, but I won't describe them now. One way to check for the insert is called restriction mapping. You cut the plasmid with particular restriction enzymes, then run the products on a gel and check their sizes. Since you know the sequence of the plasmid, you can predict how big the fragments should be, and so you can tell whether an insert of about the right size has been added to the plasmid. For example, suppose you have two EcoR1 sites on the starting plasmid that are 500 bases apart. Then, between these sites, you add an insert that is 1,000 base pairs long. If you cut the recombinant plasmid with EcoR1, you would expect to see a fragment of 1,500 base pairs instead of 500. Another way to see if DNA has been inserted into your plasmid is to do PCR, using primers that flank the predicted insert. If you see a PCR product of an appropriate size, that is evidence that your plasmid contains your insert. A third way to check for the presence of the insert is to denature the plasmid and incubate it with an oligonucleotide probe specific to the insert sequence. This could be done by southern blotting, for example. If the probe binds to the plasmid, then that suggests that the insert is present. If you think about these three methods, though, none of them guarantees that the insert was incorporated into the plasmid in exactly the way you wanted it to be, without any errors. Just because an insert of about the right size is present in the plasmid, that does not mean that something unexpected, like a mutation, didn't happen at some point in the process. So the most informative way to check for the correct incorporation of your insert into the plasmid is to determine the DNA sequence of the plasmid. That way you can see exactly what happened during your digestion, ligation, and transformation steps. In the next two videos, I'll describe a couple of ways we can sequence DNA.